Thank you. All right, so let me start by sharing my screen. Okay. Yeah. The only reason that I'm starting today's session with this screen is because I just wanted everyone to be aware that at the end of this slide deck, we have, the second last screen is where you have all the sessions that we've done until now. The recordings are available here. Other than that, of course, they are part of the meeting request also, but you don't have to search for it. I have not updated all the recordings. I am going to be doing that. I'll try to do it by today itself. But yeah, so this is going to be available for everyone to take a look at it at a later point too. Yeah. All right. So today is going to be the second last session of our series. And we will be looking at the last three principles that are there. Okay. So until now, we've looked at visibility of system status. We looked at match between system and the real world. Amazing examples we gathered there. We looked at user control and freedom so that, if the user wants to really have emergency exit, wants to change the route or undo things. Then we looked at the fourth principle, consistency and standards, which is internal consistency, external consistency, internal standards, external standards, language, user interface, visuals, icons, all of that. So standardization of that. We looked at error prevention. How can we have constraints so that to prevent errors? Other than that, for anybody who's could just lose some task that they have done and just could miss out on certain things, how do you show an alert? What are different ways that you just prevent errors, right? And we looked at that. Recognition rather than recall is where we said that, okay, a recall is a bit difficult. It is a bit taxing on users' mind because they have to recall from their memory. So how can we, different ways of the product can have recognition considered where they can just access something that they have recently seen or want to, recently seen, recently searched. They have stacked something in a component that you have given them to stack, like bookmarking and things like that. So how can you just reduce recall and increase recognition on your product? Then we looked at flexibility and efficiency of use. We saw that there are different types of users. They start as a novice users to become experts on the system. How do you start supporting them from that journey? How do you start having guided interface versus eventually how can you just give support, repetitive actions or shortcuts, and all different types of features without impacting the cost of the product, right? So these are things that we saw. Now we are on the eighth principle. We are going to be looking at ninth and 10th as well today. So please have all your attention, be collaborative, but we will not be able to take a lot of questions and discussions in today's call, just probably some highlighting ones you can bring up. And then the Friday session is going to be a deep dive and looking at different angles, right? Okay. So aesthetics and minimalistic design, right? If aesthetics, we understand anything that is eye-pleasing is aesthetics. Minimalistic design is something that is been a trend for certain times, from a Scandinavian style of design. If anybody here has studied minimalism, they would understand that, okay, it is it's called as a minimalistic design because it is a reduction of whatever is and keeping things to minimal. Okay, however, when we look at this design principle from a UI aspect, it is not that trend. Okay, minimalist design as a trend, if people have followed it, came way later after this principle. Before, you know, the principle was done before, and this the minimalistic trend came much later. Okay, so let's not get confused with that. Here, what it does it mean is, one should have aesthetics, because aesthetics are pleasing. You know that whenever you enter a beautiful place, it could be anything. It could be a shop. It could be a place that you are visiting. It could be even an hospital that is not scary, not very boring and sad, but something that you feel comfortable, right? Looking at, you think that things are going to fall in place. Automatically, your mind starts saying that, oh, I'm at the right place. This seems to be the right place, right? If you've gone to a school to take your child's admission, especially when the kids are younger, you know, you would want to see that, you know, how this school is really empathized with the kids of this age and made the place look beautiful and welcoming, all of that, right? And you start feeling, oh, this seems to be the right school. And of course, you're going to be looking at all other aspects of it. You're going to be critically looking at it. But before you venture into the second stage of analysis, that if this is right or wrong, the first is what comes to your eyes, right? So aesthetics are important. However, it is also important that they are handled carefully. There is a balance. Too much of aesthetics, too much of decoration that the user is not going to benefit out of is not great, right? So it is very careful kind of handling that one has to do. They've given two visuals here, right? Here, both are teapots. What you see here is aesthetical. However, and this looks minimal, you know, it doesn't have all of these curvy shapes and all of that. This seems very straightforward, very functional. Now, the problem with this is, while this is aesthetic, it is also very difficult to clean this, correct? All of these corners, especially here, it's going to be very difficult to clean. This doesn't seem to be that. This seems to be really straightforward to clean, manage and all of that. So this is what this principle really says. While aesthetics are important, see to it that they don't come in between the functionality or the intent of the user, the goal that the user is really actioning out. Don't let it come in between, right? So there has to be a very conscious balance between aesthetics and how you are projecting the functionality. Okay, why am I not able to move ahead? Okay, so this is what we saw. Attractive things work better is what the perception is. It may be, it may not be the case, right? Not necessarily attractive things could work better, and things that look very drab don't work better. That is not there, but that is a perception, and user's perception is something as designers we have to be very conscious, because there are certain default perceptions, certain default behaviors of humans that we have to always keep in mind and design appropriately, right? Okay. While you see to it that there is, you know, you want to make your interfaces attractive, pleasing, interesting, welcoming, all of that, see to it that you prioritize relevant information, right? Okay. Let's look at examples. When you look at some of these, you know, this is something that, you know, probably this is something which is a presentation, or it could be a website. This is typically Google. Now, Google could have just given a search bar and that is it. They could have just make it as simple and drab. If they continue to give their logo, the Google logo every time, you know, it becomes, at a point of time, you lose that kind of element of interest or, you know, engagement or that joy that you receive whenever you see a different kind of a visual here. So how do you see to it, even if you're product is not able to, you know, it doesn't really, now Google is Google, what is it doing? It is just a searching mechanism, right? You can just have do a search, simple search. There is nothing there. But still, this one aspect of aesthetics, while it is also giving you information, it is just not flowers and mountains and things like that, but it is with some kind of an intent, right? It also has certain purpose. So this makes things interesting to whoever lands every day on the site. It is important to have a good first impression. What gives a good impression? Now, there are a lot of gestalt principles that are in place. There are things that you can keep it, things organized. Any place that you see that, okay, it is organized versus things are messy. When things are messy, you just, you know, don't want to enter there. You don't think, oh, there is going to be a lot of mess. I cannot clean this, or I cannot, you know, find what I want. I have come here to look for. So that's impossible for me to do. So a very well organized, well laid out, positioned as per needs, what is going to be the first thing that the user is going to be looking at when they land upon this, are questions that you have to you know, also take care of. So attractive things work better is the perception that we saw. Aesthetics establish and reinforce brand's identity. When we say Apple, right? When we say MacBooks, or when we say what else? I think Apple is one of the brands that really at an a phase, it really stood out from everything else. Not necessarily that's the case now. There are other brands who have really caught up and are also doing better. But there was a time that because of its aesthetics, and when I'm saying aesthetics, it is not only the gadgets or the devices, it is also the complete branding. The way they did it was so aesthetically appropriate, and it ran across all their products, that the brand identity became really strong. So when you're working on your products, you have to see to it, and you have to work with your customers to understand how much of that brand you need to reflect in your product. And also see, you know, even if the customer doesn't ask you, you can do your own research, look at their brands, look at the specific segment. So if you are doing it for, say, you know, say higher education, for a particular customer, you know, what are they doing in higher education space? What are they projecting in their marketing, messaging, all of that, right? There has to be a continuation, because eventually the user has looked at the marketing material and then they're coming to your product, all of that. So there has to be that seamless transition or a journey of the user from the marketing material to the site. Right, and there are a lot of things that come in between, but you know, as products itself, at least, you know, marketing material, their website, all of that, and your product, is there any kind of aesthetics that you can continue from there to here, is something that you have to be conscious about. And some customers may just not think about it. Just some project managers who are front-ending from the customer's side may just not realize it. But this is a responsibility of the designer. Your business analyst, your project manager, your delivery manager, your salesperson would not come up with this information. Sometimes they will just give you a branding guidelines and say, ah, follow this, right? But what does the really brand talk about? What is their language, right? How casual it is, or how formal it is, all of those things, right? So that is part of language also, is part somewhere part of aesthetics also, because the font style, the words that you're using, all of that also becomes important. And of course, there is an overlap with standards, your internal standards also. Okay, moving ahead. It is important that the noise, when we say reduce noise, this becomes visual noise, right? I believe everyone understands what a visual noise is. There are certain, if you land on certain websites, especially, if I can give you an example of, say, the news sites, right? You've seen that there is, you know, even the newspaper for that matter, and that is how they have continued from the newspaper, the physical world of the newspaper, to the website. Some apps, which are mobile apps for news, they have changed that format. But if you look at websites, they have carry forward with the physical aspect of news, and sometimes it becomes too much because you're not seeing recently sites that you are exposed to as a user looking at so many columns of information at one go, and it becomes really bothering to see so much, and that's noise. That is visual noise. So reduce your visual noise. See to it that user is receiving information as they proceed, right? There is disclosure as they access, move ahead, relevant, most important upfront, and all of that, right? Display relevant information upfront, maximize the signal number of elements with high informational value, minimize the noise elements with low informational value. Exactly what we said. Maximize the signals. What do signals mean and what does noise mean? These are opposites. Signals are for users to take action, complete their actions. You know why the user has come to that page, so give him adequate signals for them to complete that action. What is noise, which is distracting, which is information which is not required then. It is low information value in the information architecture point of view. And you know, you can gradually bring the user wherever it is, bring the information wherever it is relevant. These are good examples. Very, very, very less noise. While it is telling you, it is giving you the most important information upfront, anything that the user needs at this point of time. It's stacked it nicely on one side. It is also giving you the same information in this visual manner so that you know, you can really identify it very quickly and be able to action it out accordingly. Nothing else. It is not telling you how many people have benefited out of Duolingo, case studies, and things like that, right? So very minimum information and good. Second, why also is very important, right? Why is that they are not talking about case studies and all of that? There are reasons. I mean, let's not venture into each of these examples right now because it will, you know, then too much to focus on one example. But we can, if you want to, we can bring this topic up again on the Friday discussion. Let's look at the Learning It site. Again, this is a marketing site, right, that we have. It's a corporate site. It is intended to market. So it is telling you, it's like, you know, testimony that we have so many people and so many people have got 46 million lives impacted through our education services. So this is like a marketing, but then, you know, this is the impact. It's not giving you the project details. It is not showing you a lot of happy faces, a lot of student happy faces. And if it has one image, this will keep animating. And that is why you see that this is, I have captured it while it was animating. And you know, one at a time, it is giving you information rather than this being a collage of a lot of things and a lot of statements and a lot of pointers here, right? Okay. So we've seen that aesthetics play an important role, and not necessarily that you need to have big visuals or big colors and things like that. Aesthetics as required by your user, as appealing to your user, not anywhere digressing from the intent of your product is also very important. See to it that your signals are clear and your noise is limited. Okay. So usability is both an art and a science. Always remember that. Never fall only for in the trap of saying that, okay, checkbox 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I've done, I'm good. Okay. So why is it called as science? Is because there is a methodical way of approaching to it versus art, which is more intuition, which is also there. So it's a mix of that, and this is more pleasing, and this is more logical, this is more functional, while this is more welcoming. So it is it's a balance of both of these things, and this has to be always, the designers should always consider this. Avoid irrelevant or rarely needed information upfront, right? We spoke about this. Communicate visually, textually, don't decorate, right? Just decoration. Sometimes when you want to show visuals and content, and you know, there is so many times, you know, where, especially if you have worked with learning designers in our organization or outside, you would see that, you know, they will say, okay, let's put a visual somewhere because this is becoming a very text heavy thing. What is that visual you put? You know, is it something that is just going to be a visual just as aesthetics, or is it going to be leveraging the whole communication that you want to do. Then, so that's the difference between just having decoration while being able to communicate the message along with the text, right? So this is also very important. A picture can say 1,000 words. You've heard this million times, but only if it's a useful picture. Extremely important, right? Because it is saying 1,000 words, so you better make it a picture that is worth spending that time, and all the 1,000 words are giving the message that it has to give them, give, right? Okay. Before moving to the next one, any quick thoughts? I can give just a minute for that. Any reflection, any thoughts, what we saw? Aesthetics and minimalist design. Any point that comes to your mind?
I want to add one point.
Yes.
That is, we can see that few years back, we can see this all messy design, unnecessary design. But now a modern design, nowadays, people are using less design and not noisy, you know, very straightforward design we are using.
Yeah. So, sorry. So what you wanted to, sorry, you are comparing between a, you know, with a flat design. Are you comparing?
Yeah, flat buttons? And very minimum design and very clean design. So modern design, what we are doing are pretty much straightforward. And a few years back when we started our career, so that time people use lot of things like, you know, that brushes and the other things. So if we open those kind of designs, we can see that lot of cluttered design or noisy design we could see. So now it is, yeah, design pattern has been changed.
All right, let's move on to the next one. Okay. So the next one is about help users recognize, diagnose, and recover from errors. Okay. What does this mean? Anytime the user works, you know, executes an action and lands, you know, she looks at an error, how do you really see to it that they are able to understand what is diagnosed? They should be able to understand what went wrong, right? And recover from those errors. This is quite straightforward, I think. This is handled quite neatly in most of the products these days, but very important. So, okay, now we can move ahead with this. Error messages should be highly noticeable, indicate how users must repair. Right. Okay. People don't want to read. Okay. Many a times what happens on the net, and that is something, again, something which research says, things to remember. Right, we are talking about people typically don't read, and with this whole new era where you have so many visuals thrown at you, so many short information, if people are on Instagrams, right, or say YouTubes, there are, you're receiving really small information, knowledge in just say 60 seconds, right? You're receiving a small concept or a small topic, so the whole aspect of focus has reduced. People have become extremely lazy to read. So how much, if you're giving an error message, see to it that it is clear, it is concise, doesn't have big explanations, right? Also tells the user what went wrong and what you need to do. If you want to really correct this quickly, here it is, correct it. Upfront, give them information to correct it. Okay, and users are attentive when they want to recover from an error. Now this is very important, right? Okay, let's see. Now there are two examples. Okay, I did a arbit search on Myntra. Okay, this is something that I searched for, and this is, you know, something very important that I realize, and this is again, it is not just in the principle, this is what I also personally feel, is that there are no results found for this. Showing results for this instead, what does this really mean? What they wanted to do was, they did not want me to look at a blank screen, which I understand. They always want to push content to the user. But this is extremely bothering from a user's perspective. What is it telling me? While it showed me all of this, this was just an information that I could have, if I remove this. One second. I'll just remove this because I've highlighted, you see it. But if I don't highlight it, imagine I did a search and I'm looking at this directly, all of these images. I just did not notice that it did not pick up what I searched for. Now, this is something that was really a bad search I did. But imagine that I could have just got a spelling mistake, right? A small error, and it could just have shown me something else. It's so bothering. Right? So how to correct is a different thing, right? Okay, something similar that Google is also doing. And what happens is, typically as UI designers, UI designers also, we keep observing what others are doing, and we do that. I do that also, that, okay, what is Myntra doing? What is Amazon doing? Because these are e-commerce sites, and if we have to do something very similar to an e-commerce search results, all of that, we keep observing the trends. But very consciously you have to do that, is because if they're doing something wrong, you have to put some thought on correcting it. Now look at what Google is doing. Again, something similar, right? I did one search. It is showing me this. So it is saying very upfront, showing results of this for this. Search instead for this. What does that mean? It showed me these many results, by the way. I've just not taken it in the capture. Okay. What is Google Fonts doing? Okay. It is telling you, visually it is telling you, hello, we did not find anything. Okay. Exactly this term that I searched for. We did not find, can't find fonts, any fonts with this, whatever you search for. Clear your filters and try again. Okay. Myntra, the intent is different. Completely pushed for you to purchase, right? So you need to keep looking for something or the else on Myntra so that you can pick up. So any e-commerce site would not do what they have done here, because they have a different agenda. Google would not do because they have a different agenda. Okay, and I think Google used to do this earlier, and they have changed the strategy, because I remember coming to a page and they'll say, correct some of these things. I vaguely remember, because, intermediate they used to have. Ours are educational products, right? Then we cannot really show just anything to the user. So it becomes very important to tell the user that, okay, whatever you've taken an action, if this is just search result that I'm comparing, but it could be bigger actions, right? You have published something, you have assigned something to students, and things could go wrong, right? You have imported a course from somewhere, and it was supposed to be updated and then shared with the students. Something went wrong in between, right? It could be anything. How does the end user become aware that there is something that went wrong during this task that was the system was supposed to do? After I completed my action, in the background the system was doing something. It did not do that. It was either incomplete, it was completely failed, whatever it was, or it was complete. Complete is good, but here the context is about giving user the help that is required, right? So in that case, how do you see to it that they understand that what went wrong, and how do you correct it? Extremely important. Okay. Error messages should be brief and to the point. They should give adequate information. However, they should not be too elaborate. Inform how the system works in short. Right? wherever it is required, right? So that the user is able to, next time when they are processing that information, they understand, oh, this is what the system is going to be doing. I have to do this 1, 2, 3, 4. So the system is able to process this better. Use hypertext links that connects a concise error message to a page with additional reading material or explanation of the problem. What does that mean is, for example, you know, you have to, you know, imagine that you have to give some information here when there is an error that occurs, that do 1, 2, 3, 4, right? You give it as probably an hyperlink. So you give some concise information there, give a hyperlink, and then you show, lead them either to the help, right? Where they have more information there. But don't overdo what they are saying is, you know, too many of these things are a bit difficult for the user to, you know, you have to have basically come up with different ways that this can be avoided. That is what it is intended to say. Okay. So, yeah, this is a very straightforward one from considering that, you know, how help should be provided to the users so that it is understood, they understand where things went wrong and how can they correct themselves. Any thoughts? The language is very important here. As they, you know, mentioned it, it has to be plain, simple language that the user, your end user, understands. Again, you know, we looked at other principles. So you have to understand your user's language, not your product's technical language, right? And put it very simply. Yeah.
Yes, Rupali Providen. So this is similar to the error prevention theory, the same kind of.
This is after the error occurs.
After the error occurs, okay.
Right. So after the error occurs, what happens? You typically go into any of your scenarios. You think about your scenario. You did 1, 2, 3, 4, and there is an error that occurred. Okay. What happens at that point of time? You have to understand why the error occurred. Is the system informing you why the error occurred? Was there a system failure? Was there an internet failure? Was there something that you did wrong because of that error has happened? How do you correct that error?
Okay.
Right? How do you correct that error is also very important information. We could not complete your request. Fine, you could not. But why you could not? Tell me why you could not. Or what should I do? Should I come back at a specific time to complete this? You know, whatever it is, based on your system and your product and all of that. How do you see to it that you clearly explain the user in simple, plain language that the user understands what went wrong? How can I correct it for myself for the next time?
Okay. Now it's clear.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks for asking that question. Okay. Let's move to the next one, and which is the last one. Help and documentation. Right, extremely important, always important, and different ways that it can be handled. It can be categorized in two ways. Okay, when we look at help, it can be categorized in two ways. One is proactive help, and another is reactive help. Okay. Proactive help. So these can be onboarding tutorials, contextual tips, contextual help that you give to the users, tool tips, wizards, and all of these examples. What is reactive help? When the user could not find something when the system did not give them adequate guidance. And you know, what is all of this? This is all, you know, related to a lot of other things, but it is right, you know, telling you that, okay, did you give, if I am going to be entering some information, did you give me adequate information for me to do that correctly? Did it tell me what this, if you have launched a new feature, did you tell me how this feature has to be used? Did you give me some kind of information? After I complete, or when I don't understand, not even if I don't complete, you know, when I don't understand, if I don't find that in help, with the proactive help, then I, as a user, I will start searching for things. I'll start looking out for that help, right? And that is the reactive help, which is the help documentation, tutorials, and all of that. Again, we saw that users typically are lazy to read a lot, right? So people going to help documentation is a rare thing. And rare thing as in people, I'm not saying everybody, people may want to start by understanding help documentation. We have seen that people are so, we have, you know, in your family also, in your friends, you would see that any new, you know, you buy a new AC or you find a new refrigerator or a music system, they will go through the manual. There are people, there are unique people also around us. They will like to go through the manual completely. And this could be your, you know, dad's age and that kind of people also. You know, they like to go through the complete manual, go through it and all. But now users now, what we see mostly, typically don't want to go to the help documentation level, right? And not want to go through tutorials. If they find it difficult, they will go. If your product is not something that is giving in context help to do things, it is not guided enough, they will have to go here, right? And there is no harm. Of course, you have to support. You have to support for reactive help too. Okay. Now, very interesting. In proactive help, there are two categories. Okay. Just be attentive here. Proactive help, I'll just quickly talk about push revelations and pull revelations. Okay. There are two. Okay. In proactive, everybody understands the word proactive, right? That before, you know, you, if you're going to be late for a meeting, you in advance proactively tell that, okay, I'm going to be late. If you have applied for a leave, which is probably 1 week down the line, you just proactively let everybody know that I am going to be late. So see to it that everything is in place before I go on a chutti. So what you're doing is you're not become reactive. You are proactive to see to it that things fall in place, right? So you can apply to a lot of logic. So proactive is before things happen, you take certain action, right? So that things go smooth. That is what it is. So as we saw, proactive help can be two ways. One is help that you push to the user, and the proactive help is something that gets pulled. Okay, gets pulled is the user pulls it, and push is the product pushes it. Okay, very interesting. Be conscious about it when you're observing products do this. And in your mind, see how much useful that is. Because in the new age apps, you will see both of these applied multiple places. Okay. Now, what is proactive help that is push? Is that any new feature that is launched on a product? One example, okay, I'm giving. You are letting the user, now user is doing something else, okay? The user is doing some other actions, just discovering your product, or probably, you know, is a regular user, has come to the product to execute certain actions. And suddenly somewhere from somewhere, you just show that, oh, by the way, we have added a new feature and you can do this and that and that and that here. User did not ask for that. It was not in the user's journey. User was doing something else altogether. Kuch context nahi tha, suddenly you've shown me something irrelevant. What happens? Look at it, you're in your regular routine, right? You are doing completely absorbed in your work, or you're watching your interesting Netflix series, and your parent, somebody comes and say, by the way, for food today, no, I've done this. You say, okay, I'll take a look at it later, okay? You're not really, you're absent there. You're more engrossed in your Netflix series, right? Something similar, user is taking an action on the product and you show something. That time you're just not interested to look at it. So there, while this is done by products, because they want to keep, you know, they want to let the end user know that, by the way, we have have added this addition in here. So that information is also important that the user needs to understand. But the problem is the user is not attentive to it. They might just ignore it. And probably later on, if they say, ah, kuch to yahan pe beech mein aaya tha, there's something popped up, but I ignored, what was that? I'm not able to recall what was that. That typically happens, right? So while our marketing team, our product team pushes for showing information upfront, when I'm saying upfront, you know, just understand if this is push revelation, push help that is there, okay? What it says, it pushes help content with no regard for what the user is trying to do at that moment of time. Ignored as they get it in the way, right? Things are, this is all in my way. I'm not doing anything here. Why are you telling me anything about the energy saver is on? Right now I'm, assigning things to the teacher or things like that, right? Challenging to remember since it is not relevant to the immediate goal. So it becomes very difficult. So this is one kind of a thing. You have, even if you do this, implement it, also understand the user may just ignore it and just not realize that they have seen it. What is pull revelations? Now, this is another help that you categorize as proactive, is because it is more contextual. User has selected, I want to look for privacy and security. While looking for privacy and security, they are browsing through all of this upfront that is telling you what it this stands for. Right? This is giving me information, contextual information, tips that are relevant to the user's task. Now, this can be, you know, the way it's based on completely on the complexity of that feature, how much information that you would want to give. Just a single statement is enough. Is a tooltip enough? Is, you know, something like this going to be required, where you put an explanation what this is, and you might want to say, if you need more help on this, you know, you can click on this, or there is a video available here that we have given. Look at that video, whatever it is, right? Support it with whatever information that is required, but see to it that it is not overwhelming, right? Adequate information is important, okay? So this is pull help, right? Or pull revelation of help. Why is it pull? Because the user clicked on it, and that is when you are saying that, okay, by the way, in this page, we have updated something like this, right? That is what the pull information is. Or when the user is saying, you know, you're here, and the user say, probably you have clicked on say extras and you're here, and this is what is popped out, or you have clicked on this, and that is when this popped out, then it becomes relevant to the user then, right? And instead of once when the user had come to the dashboard, you show one kind of a page which shows that, okay, by the way, in extras, we have added something like this, not relevant. That is push help, right? So before we move ahead, in reference to proactive help, which is the push revelation and pull revelations, any thoughts, comments, questions? The aspect here is that we understand the difference between both of these, because it gets very easy to get carried away with what typical popular products are doing. However, it is very important as designers that we critically see every update or improvement that the product is doing, also because, you know, it may be good, it may not be great from a usability aspect, and if they are doing that, are they also supporting it with any other way? So all of these things you have to be extremely critical when you are referring to all of these products. Okay, I'll move ahead. Reactive help. Okay, we looked at, let me just go a few slides back, we saw proactive help. In proactive help, there are two categories, push and pull. In reactive help, we saw that, okay, what there is elaborate information, help documentation, step-by-step information, tutorial, da da da. So we are going to be looking at example of reactive help. When you have product which is elaborate, you are working on a platform, you would want to have an elaborate help. Again, it has specific features that are helpful. One is that you have a, you typically want to have a search, because that is, the user has not found something as guidance in the main product or wants to understand the details of that aspect, because the user is going to be, you know, probably the user is always importing a type of content. Now the user wants to import a different type of content. We don't know if that is possible on the product. I've never done that. That is when I would want to come here in the help section and see that if that is possible, right? Lot of reasons that people would come to the help section. It has to be comprehensive, completely giving you a clean explanation, all that is required to be able to execute, okay? Detailed information. It should highlight keywords. That is because, imagine the user has come here to quickly scan through and see. How many have you, how many of you have experienced that, you know, probably it is your mobile, you know, is doing something weird. It could be a printer where you want to really print and get yourself, you know, things printed quickly and move out. You're relying on that printer. It could be just any kind of a system which suddenly goes wrong and you have to take support of a help. It could be a manual, it could be an online, it could be through YouTube support, whatever it is. What are you really looking for? You're looking out for those keywords that you are wanting to see, which are, which that what is, you know, there is an error message that you see. So you want to look for that error message in the system and say, I want to reach and see how do I correct this error, right? So get into the shoes of the user, see, understand what are the use different cases that where the user is going to be landing on this help and looking out for information. See to it that the content that you put is bulleted, numbered, properly in steps, supported with graphics, videos, screenshots, adequate explanation based on the feature, examples, whatever it is, provide that. Search and relevant grouping categories, right? So you see relevant grouping and categories of information that you don't, I don't want to just give and search. I know where the problem is. I want to go, you know, just click on that product, or it could be a grouping, right? That, okay, I want to look at creation of new content. Probably you not don't have products like this, but you can have, say, create a creation of content, assigning content, right? Then something else, right? So it is completely based on what the highlight journeys of your users are, based on that categories. Frequently viewed would be typically at the top. You might want to show that, you know, they are calling this trending, but this is like, you know, typically when we say set up and install, what would you want to install? Account and billing related, what are those topics that, you know, people typically look for, are extremely key, people are searching for, put them at the top up front on the screen. So these are certain ways in which that the principle explains that you can make your help elaborate, extensive, comprehensive, you know, a lot of ways that, like, for example, when I click on this, you know, it could just give me the recent searches, and when I start typing my terms, it will start giving me topics in reference to those terms that are there, right? You can have the use of a chatbot that is there just to give you quickly something, and it is, it could be probably searching whatever is here. You can have your chatbot in your main product, which is really going to be picking up a topic here. So we have seen how the proactive help and the reactive help can be blended together in the product, or, and while it can also be separated, your help, which is this help, can be a completely a separate product, right? It can also be based on, if you sign in, you know, it is going to be also giving you the products that you have purchased only. There are different ways of doing that. It completely is based on what your product is, who your end user is, what is the kind of help that they're going to be looking for. Yeah. All right. So we looked at three things here. We looked at proactive help and two categorization between proactive help, which is the push and the pull. Proactive help, when it is push, not pull, when it is push, distracts users, let me just correct it right away. Okay, so proactive help when it is push. Distracts users from their core task. So it's important that the help is timely, okay, informative and relevant. So timely when we say is full. Yeah. Anticipate when your users will need help and provide relevant information, again, which is pull. Keep help content brief, to the point, and easy to scan. Yeah. That's about this topic, help and documentation. Thoughts?
FAQs can be in the reactive section, right?
Yes. Good. That comes under the point that we saw here, which is frequently viewed topics can be your frequently asked topics, right? There are different ways that people really put that as a the headers could be different, the way they are displaying it could be different, but primarily it is the topic that is frequently visited.
Tour guide also under the proactive help step, right?
When you said tour guide, do you just elaborate what you say?
Under the application, I open up open an application first time, and they show me a tour guide, guide information,
correct. Tutorial. Correct. Which is more like why the purpose of that tour guide is it is onboarding you.
Onboarding.
Correct. So that is the purpose of that. So it is onboarding tutorial, which is right. But you have to also see to it, because it is push information. The product has pushed for it. The user has not asked for it. See to it that you are giving relevant information, only information that the user really needs, just with a minimal information, just that the user is aware of, because it is something that they might just, you know, it's not relevant to them that time. So just look at it and, okay, theek hai. Okay, they might just not, it may not just register to them. So see to it that it is not too much, it is just adequate. It is not elaborate, or give all of that elaborate information in your pull. Okay. Yeah. And it is very important as designers that we start using the correct terminology, right? So what the purpose of that? Like what you rightly said, right? It is a guide. It's a tool. But then this guide can be used at a lot of places. But if when you're saying that it is at the start that I'm using, it is typically onboarding, right? So use when you are discussing it, people around you are not going to be talking about these terms. But as designers, it is very important that this language or this keyword, these keywords have to be used. So keep reading when you're talking to other designers also, use the same language. Don't generalize or don't lose the effectiveness of those keywords. Yeah. What else? All right, I think any points, anybody else, any points?
So it's me, Rupali, you said that proactive help me if user is doing something else and that pop-ups comes in between. But in this onboarding tutorial, the user's focus is completely on that particular section, like, because the user is the first time user. So will that stand in that proactive help only?
It is proactive help, and it comes in the category of push. Both is there, both is true. And it is also important for you to onboard the user by giving all of that information, right? Now, from a designer's perspective, how much information would you give at that point of time becomes important. So the principal doesn't say don't do it.
Yeah.
But what the principal is saying is, understand the user is reading it. Okay. Probably, like, for example, if you don't have anything else on the screen going on that time, and if it is on your mobile, right? So it is on your mobile. Imagine there is nothing that is happening in the background as actions. Just to onboard, you are swiping a few screens. You're consciously looking at it, right? So that is very guided. So that is something that is not distracting to the user, that time point of time. If they don't want it, they can just skip it.
So there is nothing good, bad in this. This is as per the experience what the current user is on.
Yeah, so onboarding information is important.
So
give limited, you know, really relevant information there, right? But don't expect the user will be able to do everything. When the user is on the product and doing a particular task, that is when you give the required information, which is a pull revelations that we saw. Another thing is that imagine it's a desktop environment or even a mobile environment, and the user is doing something else, and suddenly there is some information that slides up saying that, okay, this is something that we have introduced, or this is something that you can also do it this way, and things like that, which is at that point of time is not relevant to you. And there are products who've done that, right? That is when it becomes, you know, okay, all right, thank you for informing me, but right now I'm not looking at it. So you can just, the users may just put it on the side. All right, we are at the end of the hour, and what we have here is we have completed all the principles. What we are going to be doing in the next session on Friday is we are going to be looking at examples that are relevant to the last three principles that we have seen. I will also have a form that is going to be at the end of it circulated, which is more like a quick assessment of, you know, how much something that you have gathered from this session. So some questions, quiz kind of a thing there. It is going to be after the session, after the Friday session, it is going to be circulated with you. Okay, that is how we end this first session. I would still call it a series and the first series, because that doesn't mean that, you know, just because we've spoken about heuristics and we have understood each principle, we understand it thoroughly as designers and we are able to apply it. There could be certain, still some areas that needs to be refined. So there could be some, you know, Hemant and I'm thinking about how we can still take it ahead and really have probably working sessions, working assignments, some kind of way in which that this information is just not read and kept aside, but is absorbed and reflected in the work that we do. Yeah. All right. That is it for today's session then. Thank you. I hope okay, it was
Rupali. Rupali, Friday ka jo call hai wo calendar mein nahi dikha raha hai. So is it for me or everyone?
No, it is all, you're right. Thanks for informing. Mujhe bhi nahi dikha raha. Ha, theek hai. I'll request for that. Thanks for pointing that out.
Okay. Thank you.
It'll be the same time, 10 o'clock on Friday. Okay. Yeah? Okay. Yeah. Right. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Have a good day. Bye.